This is it. The time has finally come. It's just far too important not to cover here on British Muzzleloaders. It is perhaps the most iconic rifle of British Empire and Commonwealth military history. It is, of course, the short magazine Lee Enfield.
The rifle, short magazine Lee Enfield, as it was initially known, served Britain, the Empire, and the Commonwealth for over 50 years. It crossed the Channel with the old Contemptibles in 1914 and accounted greatly for itself during the desperate battles of that year. Mons, Le Cateau, and Ypres. It also won a new set of spurs in the trenches that developed after it, its short length being particularly beneficial. It served throughout the Great War, with all kinds of ancillary uses devised for it, and would again be called to action a generation later during the Second World War. Its longevity would not be matched. In fact, it would continue to be used until the 1950s by Australia, it still being their service rifle during the Korean War. But this was not a rifle that just appeared out of the ether. There was a long and storied history behind it, beginning in 1888 with the adoption of the magazine rifle Mark I. With an action and magazine designed by this man, James Lee, and a barrel devised by this man, William Metford. This, the first magazine repeating rifle in British service, was later renamed the Magazine Lee Metford Mark I. In this rifle, we see the features that would become the hallmarks of this long and storied family of rifles. It had the elegant, downswept, semi-pistol grip buttstock, the distinctively hooked trigger, and the equally distinctive Lee action and detachable box magazine. These early versions had a recess cut underneath the magazine cutoff, and finger grooves milled into the forestock. As was customary to an infantry rifle of the era, it had a long barrel of 30.2 inches. This had sights mounted to it that were graduated to 1,900 yards. These, initially, were of the Lewis pattern, and featured, instead of a barleycorn, a slot milled in the top. Its bayonet could be fitted with a ring over the muzzle and a catch at the bayonet lug. It was also equipped with a long-range dial sight mounted to the left side of the forestock that was graduated from 1,800 to 3,500 yards. This would later be modified to a maximum of 2,900. It was also fitted with a safety catch mounted next to the aperture of the long-range sight. In its day, this rifle heralded a quantum leap forward from the rifle it replaced, namely the Martini Henry. The magazine, which was an 8-round, single-stack variety, had a cutoff, which enabled the rifle to be either used as a single loader or, from the magazine, as a repeater. The magazine rifle was modified, beginning in 1892, with some small, incremental changes. The Lewis sights were duly replaced with a conventional barleycorn. The safety catch was removed, and the buttstock was modified to accept the pull-through and oil bottle, the Army moving away from the use of a jag. There were some other modifications concerning the mainspring, the magazine spring, the piling swivel, and the addition of a marking disc to the butt. But visually, this modified rifle known as the Mark I Star remained virtually the same. It was this rifle that the British Army campaigned with throughout the 1890s. The two notable campaigns being the rebellion on the northwest frontier of India and the reconquest of the Sudan in 1897 and 1898, respectively. It was a good design, but even in its modified Mark I Star form, it still required a bit of tinkering, and resultingly, subsequent patterns were produced. The Mark II and Mark II Star Lee Metford and the Mark I Lee Enfield. In these rifles were a series of design improvements, including a new 10-round magazine, a safety was reinstalled on the cocking piece of the Mark II Star Lee Metford, a lightened forestock, and, ultimately in the case of the Mark I Magazine Lee Enfield, a new barrel with Enfield rifling to accommodate the unforeseen effects of hotter burning cordite ammunition. It was these patterns of rifles that saw service in South Africa during the Second Anglo-Boer War. Now, much has been made about the comparison between these rifles and what they opposed. the Mausers of the Boers. Now, that's a subject for another video. There were, however, some deficiencies when compared to more contemporary rifles. The first and foremost was their reliance on loading either the chamber or the magazine with single rounds. Another deficiency found in the suite of weapons used by the Army during the Boer War was not so much a technical problem as it was a doctrinal problem. The cavalry, especially during the first part of the war, were armed with their traditional weapons, which included a carbine. It was quickly found that this put them at a disadvantage when shooting at greater ranges against the Boers. So, perhaps the second most important of these deficiencies noted as part of lessons learned during the war was to have a common rifle for both infantry and cavalry, thus making them equal rifle for rifle on the battlefield. A deficiency was noted during the war of the British soldiers' ability to snapshoot, that is to say, engage targets which are fleeting. From this, it was deduced that perhaps a shorter rifle, and of course more emphasis in training, might be more advantageous. These two key aspects, both charger loading and a common shorter length, would dominate the decision-making process regarding the use of a new type of rifle in the post-Boer War era. Now, this process wasn't as easy as it may sound. There was resistance to the adoption of some sort of new rifle that came from the traditionalists who, seeing the cavalry's traditional role on the battlefield diminished by the adoption of an infantry weapon, perceived this to be a threat to their cherished role in shock action. There were some, in infantry circles as well, that lamented the apparent demise of a long-barreled, seemingly more accurate rifle. In the end, progress, and some might say common sense, won out. Charger loading was adopted, and a new rifle, with an intermediate length between that of the infantry rifle and the cavalry carbine, was designed. So it was, in 1902, that the rifle, short, magazine Lee Enfield was adopted for service, and would become the most iconic British military rifle of the 20th century. This new pattern of rifle was some 1.25 pounds lighter than the pattern that came before it. It was also 5 inches shorter. It did, however, maintain some of the distinctive features from patterns before. The buttstock and the Lee action with its magazine and trigger were very familiar. It did receive a new tangent-style backsight with protective wings. There was a full-length handguard that ran the length of the barrel. This protected the barrel as well as Tommy's hands from its heat. It also had the effect of cutting out any heat mirage coming off the top of the barrel and interfering with the sight picture. There was a new, distinctive nose cap, which incorporated wings to protect the front sight, bayonet attachment fittings for the fitting of the initially issued 1903 pattern 12-inch bayonet, and accommodation for a piling swivel. As discussed earlier, one of the primary considerations in adopting this new rifle was the provision for charger loading. In this, the first pattern of SMLE, this was achieved in the following way. On the left side of the receiver, there was a raised piece of metal that incorporated a notch. On the top of the bolt head, there was a sliding fitting. When the bolt was pulled to the rear, this slid forward on the bolt head, lining up the notch in its surface to that on the left side of the receiver to create a cradle for the charger to fit into. A feature carried over from the earlier patterns of magazine Lee Enfield was the provision of a magazine cutoff. Although this device, when engaged, limited the ability to load or charge the magazine, and facilitated single loading in earlier magazine Lee Enfields, its provision on the SMLE was for safety reasons only, and not for the provision of single loading. The new tangent-style backsight replaced the ladder backsight from earlier marks. The ladder-style backsight had been in service since the 1850s, and the new tangent-style was much more adjustable, both for elevation and windage. The conventional long-range dial sight was maintained, mounted in the customary spot on the left of the forestock, and the aperture being mounted next to the safety catch. So, in the immediate aftermath of the Boer War, the British Army moved forward with its new rifle at its side. It wasn't long, however, before changes were made to the existing design. Enter the rifle, short, magazine Lee Enfield, Mark III. In 1907, this new mark was approved for service. It remained essentially like the Mark I. There were, however, some cosmetic differences. The biggest change was to the way the charger was stabilized above the body or receiver of the rifle. Instead of the two-part and sometimes finicky earlier version, a piece known as the charger bridge was added above the bolt. This provided a much more stable and positive hold on the charger. This made loading easier. The backsight was changed to a slightly different pattern. The V pattern of notch in the Mark I was replaced with a U pattern. It still, however, retained its capabilities, both for range and for windage, with a windage dial next to the right side of the cap. It also added the provision of intermediate range adjustment through the use of a knurled knob that, when rotated, would adjust the slider to an intermediate setting between the 100-yard increments. The front sight was also changed. Previously, it had been a barleycorn, which is more of a triangular profile. This was replaced with a blade with parallel sides. From 1907, this back sight was modified to accommodate the new type of ammunition then entering service. The new Mark VII ammunition had a higher velocity, and the back sight ramp was milled down. The magazine cutoff was retained, although, as mentioned earlier, it was for safety reasons and not for the provision of single loading. Concurrent with the acceptance for service of the Mark III, a new pattern bayonet also entered service. The 1907 pattern, with its distinctive hooked quillon and 17-inch blade, replaced the earlier 12-inch bladed version. The quillon would later be removed and be replaced with a simple crossbar guard. As with previous marks, the long-range dial sights were retained, both in their customary places. The older marks of rifle were upgraded incrementally to match some of the features of the new Mark III. But it was generally this, the Mark III SMLE, with which the British Army marched to war in 1914. It would take over a year of horrific fighting before any other changes were implemented. Those changes were incorporated into a new mark, the rifle short Magazine Lee Enfield Mark III Star. The opening battles of 1914, Mons, Le Cateau, and the First Battle of Ypres, were followed in 1915 with the Second Battle of Ypres, Neuve-Chapelle, Gallipoli, and the Battle of Loos. What became apparent and had to be accommodated for was the utter wastage in weaponry and materiel, over and above the horrible cost in human life. For this reason, from 1916, economies were made to lessen the burden on wartime manufacture. The long-range dial sights were omitted. The adjustable wind gauge on the back sight leaf was replaced with a fixed cap. The striker collar was modified, and the sling swivel lugs were omitted from in front of the magazine. Next to the simplified sights, the biggest change was in the omission of the magazine cutoff. My SMLE Mark III Star is an earlier 1916 version and has only some of the changes listed previously. The butt retains the trap for the oil bottle and pull-through. The sling swivel lugs in front of the magazine are still present. It retains its charger bridge and the newer, simplified backsight. As you can see, the differences between the Mark III and the Mark III Star are quite minor, but they did fit the bill for wartime economy. It's important to note that, like my rifle, examples were made using older parts, those first being used before the introduction of newer patterns. Here, we can see in detail, in the lack of milling in the body, the absence of any provision for a magazine cutoff. Whereas the Mark III had a windage adjustable backsight, the Mark III Star did not, and as mentioned, had a fixed cap. An interesting point is that despite the absence of the knurled windage knob, the backsight protector on the right-hand side was still offset, this never being changed throughout the war. The close ranges at which trench warfare was fought negated the necessity for any extra long-range engagement, and therefore the Mark III Star was manufactured without the provision cut into the wood for the long-range dial sight and the aperture. So this brings us to the end of the evolutionary process, from the Mark I magazine rifle, or Lee Metford Mark I, to the SMLE, or short Magazine Lee Enfield, Mark III Star. From 1916, the manufacture of this rifle would predominate in the factories and workshops of Great Britain. Throughout its early service life, the SMLE used generally two kinds of ammunition. From its introduction, the rifle was sighted to use the marks of ammunition then in service. This would have been either the Mark II or the Mark VI. This style of 303 round was generally the last pattern to use the 215-grain round-nosed bullet. By the latter part of the first decade of the 20th century, this type of round had become obsolete. It was replaced, as it was in most armies, by a Spitzer round, that is to say a round with a pointed nose. This new round, the Mark VII, was not only lighter at 174 grains, but also offered increased performance with a muzzle velocity of some 2,400 feet per second. This had been an improvement over the earlier patterns that had a muzzle velocity of only 2,000 feet per second. This increase in performance had come about not only because of the shape of the bullet, but also due to a new kind of cordite. Cordite had been the smokeless propellant of choice for the British Empire. This had been introduced in 1891 and was characterized by its long, thin, spaghetti-like appearance. The construct of the bullet had also changed significantly. Although retaining the silvery cupro-nickel jacket, the inside was now made up of two different parts. There was a lead core, which contained 2% antimony, and the tip, which was made of aluminum. Wartime economy would see the aluminum replaced with compressed paper, fiber, or ceramic. Although initially done to ensure the bullet remained as long as possible while still maintaining its weight, this composite construction was seen to have added benefits in relation to the terminal ballistics of the bullet, the lighter tip causing it to tumble. This was the round the Army would take to war in 1914. For shooting my SMLE, I use a 210-grain bullet cast in linotype with a gas check. This is the same cartridge as was shown in the 303 reloading video. For the SMLE, there's one key difference. I found that when seated to the depth I use with the Lee Metford, the SMLE did not feed well, so when reloading for it, I seat the bullet a little bit deeper. As mentioned earlier, one of the key characteristics of the SMLE was its ability to load with a charger. Now, there were four different marks of chargers used with 303 ammunition. The ones I have are Mark IVs and date from the 1950s. They have, however, no appreciable difference to those used during the Great War. The chargers held five rounds, which were loaded in a certain way. Because of the rimmed nature of the cartridge, the rims had to alternate, with three down and two up. This ensured that no matter which way you placed the charger in the rifle, it would load correctly. To load the charger, the rounds were slid past the spring clip at the end, ensuring the rims overlapped in the appropriate fashion. You can see here how the odd number cartridges sit low in the charger, while the even numbers sit high. So positioned, the charger was a reliable way to load the rifle. This staggering technique, combined with the design of the magazine, ensured that the rims and the cartridges were lined up for proper chambering. Typically, the chargers were then placed in bandoliers of 50 rounds. There were five pockets, each holding 10 rounds in two chargers. This example is from the 1950s as well, but differs very little from the type of bandoliers used during the Great War. The bandoliers were then packaged in crates, an example of which is shown here, a reproduction made by Sam Cormier. For immediate use, the rounds of course were placed in the personal equipment of the soldier. The 1908 pattern equipment had 10 individual pouches, each holding 3 chargers, thus 15 rounds, giving a total of 150 on the man. The loading and firing of the SMLE was, by design, a speedy process. With the safety catch moved forward, the bolt was opened by lifting the handle up and to the rear. A charger of 5 rounds was removed from the pouch and placed in the charger bridge. With the thumb of the right hand placed on top of the rounds and close to the charger, a sharp downward pressure pushed the rounds into the magazine. The bolt was then closed and the safety catch applied. The charger was automatically pushed out of the way on closing the bolt. To fire the rifle, all that needed to be done was push the safety catch forward, cover your target, and squeeze the trigger. The story of the SMLE is forever linked most strongly to its service in the Great War. Millions were made, and it served all over the world, in the desert heat of Mesopotamia and Palestine, the trying conditions of both East and Southwest Africa, the arid hills of Gallipoli, in the Balkans, and of course, most prominently on the Western Front. It proved itself a reliable and serviceable weapon that was also adaptable to many other roles. As the war stagnated in the trenches, the SMLE was found to be readily adaptable to help overcome battlefield tactical situations. For instance, it was fitted with various forms of rifle grenade attachments or launchers. Later in the war, some SMLEs even becoming dedicated to this role and reinforced with wire wraps around the stock to accommodate the considerable shock of launching a 1-pound bomb off the end of the barrel. There were wire-cutting attachments also devised. These were fixed to the muzzle and featured a cutter that worked on a rotating camming action. These two examples serve to illustrate the change in the dynamic of the rifle during the war. At war's outbreak, the rifle had occupied a primacy that would never again be matched. The infantry, save some swords and revolvers in the hands of the officers, and but two machine guns per battalion, had been exclusively armed with the rifle. This was the same for most armies. Starting early in the war, the type of weaponry used by the infantry began to change. New weapons, the training to use them, and as a result, specialities began to emerge. Never again would the infantryman be simply a rifleman. By war's end, the SMLE had been joined by vastly increased numbers of machine guns, both the Vickers and the Lewis, the rifle grenade, the hand grenade, and the lighter versions of the trench mortar. All of these were manned by infantry. The rifle as a battlefield weapon had become marginalized in the vast horror of industrialized warfare. Despite this, it still had a role to play and served with the same reliability and ruggedness as it had done in 1914. But far and away, it is the image of those original regulars of 1914, using their SMLEs to great effect as they withstood German onslaughts again and again. It is in this context, that of musketry and marksmanship, that I personally, and as a result the channel, identify the most with. In the next chapter, we'll discuss the quintessential aspect of the SMLE, musketry, its myths and realities. From time to time throughout this video, I've made references to the list of changes in British war material. In it are listed many dates that correspond to the acceptance of various weapons and accoutrements. These are the dates that I've used in this video.
Hi. I couldn't finish this video without making mention of two very special people. I'm going to bet that you know who this is. And this. That's right, it's Athias and May from Sea and Arsenal. They run a fantastic YouTube channel and have only recently published a video on the early history of Lee Metford and Lee Enfield rifles. I suggest that if you haven't seen it yet, that you run, don't walk. Get over there and view it immediately. It's long, it's awesome, and it's very comprehensive.